So, hello, doctors. Khushbu this side from Harmonica Ecumenitas. It is a good privilege to have all our CME members on board, and we welcome all the audience. We welcome you from Harmonica Ecumenitas in collaboration with Jaipur Obs Gyne Society, Udaipur Obs Gyne Society, and Ajmer Obs Gyne Society for a webinar and a panel discussion, majorly to discuss on optimizing the management of fibroids across ages. And just to brief you about Harmonica Ecumenitas, we deal with total gynecology and IVF therapy, where we deal with major therapy like fibroids, endometriosis and PCOS and the whole IVF therapy. So we have a brand which is FibroEase, which has Fullodose Nutristone, the pioneer brand in this market, to manage the fibroids medically. So handing over, so I'll just welcome Dr. Usha ma'am. And yeah. Hello, Dr. Usha ma'am. We welcome you on board for our CME. She is a professor in HOD Department of Obstetric and Gyne, MGH, Jaipur. She was an ex-professor in HOD Department of Reproductive Medicine, MGH, Jaipur, professor MCMCM, Jaipur, and many more other positions. President, she is currently a president, Jaipur Obs Gyne Society 2020-21. Excellence Award for Jaipur Medical Associated 2010, and she has various experiences. She has been a member of Research Review Board, SMS Medical College, Jaipur, have been an external examiner for PT and UG exams and various publications in various major journals also. Her special interests include infertility management, academics, and research work. Handing over to Dr. Usha ma'am.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, and I welcome you all to a very interesting panel discussion on the conservative management of fibroids. And like we all know, uterine fibroids are common benign neoplasms, and they are mostly diagnosed accidentally in the asymptomatic patients, especially when they either come for a routine checkup during a pelvic examination or on a sonography for some other purpose, and accidentally you diagnose those fibroids. But many a times they are with symptoms also. So symptomatic fibroids are diagnosed much earlier, but the silent fibroids, which remain asymptomatic, are diagnosed much later. And seeing to the age, they should be individually, catered to, as per depending upon the size, the age, the obstetric requirement of the patient, and so and so forth. And so, the management should be tailored to the size, location, the patient's age, symptoms, desire to maintain the fertility, and the assess and the expertise of the treating physician. So I welcome you to this interesting webinar and a panel discussion. So in the beginning, I would like to introduce our chief speaker, Dr. Sadhana Gupta. Please put up a CV. Khushbu? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
I want the CV of Dr. Sadhana, please.
Can you see it, ma'am?
No. Yeah, now it's visible. So Dr. Sadhana is going to, we all know Dr. Sadhana very well. So I'll just give a brief introduction of her, that she's a FOCSI representative to the SFO 2018 to August 2020. And she's Vice President FOCSI 2000. She was FOCSI Vice President 2016. She's chairperson FOCSI Safe Motherhood Committee 2011-14, recipient of Dr. Mehru Dara Ansutia Best Committee Award, and organizing chairperson of Saving Mothers 2016-19, SDOG Governing Council member 2015-2020, and corresponding author, editor in the Journal of Obs and Gyne 2017-2020, and she is based at Gorakhpur. And so please support also, and we are all eager to listen to you, Dr. Sadhana.
Thank you, Dr. Usha. Thank you for the kind introduction. And thank you. Thanks for the opportunity. And first of all, I'm really over hearty thanks to Jaipur Obs Gyne Society, Udaipur and Ajmer, especially Dr. Usha Shekhawar, Dr. Prem Lata, Dr. Madhubala, Dr. Prakashan, Dr. Pritam Kothari, and Dr. Ajay Sharma. And it was a long-awaited meeting, and hope we will have a wonderful heart-to-heart and brain-to-brain discussion on medical management of fibroids. So over to Khushbu.
Thank you, Dr. Sadhana.
Yes, ma'am. We request you to welcome Dr. Pritam Kothari, ma'am, to welcome our guest of honor, Dr. Ajal Thakkar. So Dr. Pritam Kothari, ma'am, is MX Ops Gyne, President Ajmer Ops Gyne Society. She is a senior consultant, Mittal Ops Hospital, Ajmer, Director Kothari IVF Center, Ajmer, endoscopic surgeon and IVF specialist. We welcome you, ma'am, on board. And over to you, ma'am. Ma'am, 1 minute. Please unmute. Yeah.
Yeah, CV, please.
Yes.
Hello. Welcome, everyone. Good afternoon. I am here, Dr. Rajal Thakkar. In brief introduction of her, she is Professor OBGY. SCL Hospital, NHL Municipal Medical College, Ahmedabad. She was President AOGS 2018-19 and 2020-21. She is National Coordinator, Adolescent CMT Foxy, Special Interest in Adolescent Health. She has many radio, TV talks and newspaper articles on adolescent health, safe motherhood, woman empowerment, woman health, cancer awareness and COVID-19 and pregnancy. She is felicitated by Ahmedabad Red Cross, Ahmedabad Mirror, Shet VS General Hospital, Indian, and many awards from the Foxy Gastrosis Unsung Hero Award 2018, Ahmedabad Medical Association. She has international prizes, best video on breastfeeding by the WAPA, outstanding contributor of the photo shoot, project of the John Hopkins University, and invited faculty papers, posters, and lectures. She as UA Foxy Oration, West John, UA Foxy 2005, and AICOG 2006. She has got 25 research publications in her name, state, national, and international journals, author of chapters in course materials of the BAOU Foxy publications. She is organizing team of many state national level conferences, and she has other interests in writing travelogues, nature education, photography. Welcome, ma'am. Welcome for today's session.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the kind introduction.
Dr. Rajal, we welcome you to talk a few words, please.
Very good afternoon to all dignitaries. I thank Jaipur OBGYN Society, Udaipur OBGYN Society, and Ajmer OBGYN Society, and Khamma Ghani to all of you. And I thank Dr. Sadhana Gupta, ma'am, for having me here. She is an excellent teacher and doing so many academic activities. I wish her all the best for her candidature for the Foxy presidential election. And I also wish you all for the COVID-free times ahead. We are praying that the third wave doesn't come and we get to meet in person, because we were, planning for the Foxy presidential conference for Dr. Alpesh. But then we had to postpone it. And so we are looking forward to that very conference. So hopefully if there is no COVID, so I also welcome you all to Ahmedabad and welcome for our hospitality. And over to you, ma'am, for the proceedings. Thank you very much for having me here.
I also wish to like share with everybody, with all the office bearers as well as members of the society, that Dr. Rajal Thakkar is going to contest for chairperson Adolescent Health Committee, and she is a very nice, very ethical, and very highly ground to root and a person of people. So we wish you all the best, and we also request for my support for Dr. Rajal Thakkar as well as for my candidature. So thank you once again, Dr. Rajal.
Thank you, Dr. Rajal, ma'am. Welcome Dr. Madhubala Chauhan, ma'am. She is a senior professor, medical superintendent, PDZH since 2018, ex-HOD Ops Gyne Department 2018-20, senior professor, associate professor, assistant professor, and a work experience of more than 35 years. She has qualifications of MS Ops Gyne from Medical College Udaipur, and she has many paper publications also. So welcome Dr. Madhubala, ma'am. We welcome you, and hand over to Dr. Sadhana, ma'am, for the further proceedings and introduction of the panelists, ma'am.
So thank you, Khushbu. So we welcome you all the panelists, and today we are going to have the very sharing experience and your wisdom about the medical management of fibroids. And for this, we have esteemed panelists who have the diverse experience and as well as the expertise. It's my pleasure to invite Dr. Fardendra Bhardwaj. He is Associated Professor, Department of OB-GYN and MGH Jaipur, and he is running fellowship training program since April 2017. He has been Founder Secretary of Rajasthan Endoscopy Society, IAG Rajasthan Chapter, Joint President Jaipur OB-GYN Society, and Organizing Secretary Endo-Ferticon Jaipur. He has many publications, original research article on key issues. And as an endoscopic surgeon, it will really good to have his opinion that when he will consider medical management in his armamentarium. So we welcome Dr. Fardendra Bhardwaj. Next, Khushbu.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Shabdika Kulshi, she is Associate Professor in Anant Institute of Medical Sciences, Rajasthan. She has been senior resident at Rabindranath Tagore Medical College, Udaipur, India, teaching experience of 12 years and many publications to her credit. Welcome, Dr. Shabdika.
Thank you.
Next, Dr. Aditi Maurya is our next panelist. She has been postgraduate from SMS Medical College, assistant professor at SNMC Jodhpur for 3 years. And now she is presently working as associated professor in RNTMC Udaipur. She has held many posts for the Udaipur Society, for the member of FOCSI, and participated faculty in conference at many states. So Dr. Aditi, welcome. We welcome you with
Thank
a
you, ma'am.
Experience. Dr. Urmila Mahala is our next is a panelist, and she is also graduate from SN Medical College, Jodhpur. She is assistant professor in SMS Medical College for 6 years, and now she is presently associate professor in SMS Medical College, Jaipur, with 13 years of teaching experience. And she has been a good writer as well as a faculty in many conferences. Welcome, Dr. Urmila. We have a wonderful panel of teachers.
Along with this, ma'am, we have Dr. Usha, Dr. Madhubala, and Dr. Preetam also as our panelists today. So please, we can start with our panel discussion.
We don't have their CV with you.
Ma'am, they have introduced. We have introduced them. If you want.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Already introduced. Yes.
Yeah, we have. Yeah.
So we have already introduced. So let me share my slide screen. And
yes, ma'am.
We have allocated every question to every case situation or the point of discussion to 2 panelists. So if somebody is there, like Dr. Purnima says, she has got suddenly some meeting in Calcutta, some government meeting. So if any panelists wish to take the situation or want to add something, you can add. So let me share my slide. Is this visible? It is visible.
Yes, ma'am, it is visible. Yes, ma'am.
With the thanks for invite and opportunity to be August gathering and August members of the Udaipur and Ajmer Society, I bring greetings from FOCSI and SEPOG and welcome all the panelists from a very, very beautiful, hospitable culture, which is known for the culture for the Rajasthan societies. So welcome all the panelists, and just a few slides for the basics, which we know always, but we have to repeat it, that the uterine fibroids are monoclonal tumor arising from uterine smooth muscle tissue. We don't know why fibroids develop and why they grow at the various speeds. We have recognized few growth promoters like sex steroid, estrogen, and progesterone. Usually they are found in the around menopause in the fourth decade or the late third decade, but nowadays we are having fibroid across the age group. And the most common reproductive factors when we actually include in the they put the tricky situation is the adolescent, and the patient is infertile, and the additional environment factor, which is also coming in a big way as the origin or the increased incidence of fibroid, is the diet, vitamin D deficiency, and environmental toxin, as well as the like what we say, the compromised lifestyle modification. 60% of reproductive aged women are affected with fibroid, and with the routine use of ultrasound and TVS, now it can be incidence as high as 80%. But it is very important point to know that a third of myoma become only symptomatic, especially in early parent women. In India, what is the situation? Nearly 20 to 30% of Indian women in reproductive age group have the fibroid uterus. And at any given time, nearly 15 to 25 million Indian women have the fibroid uterus. So point is that India, because of our huge population and a huge young population, actually we have a lot of variety of patients, and with a very, very common gynecological situation, which we always have in our OPD, in our OTs, that we really have to have a base for the managing these fibroids. We all know that as an expert, there can be intramural, subserous, submucous, and it is upon the level of the growth, and it is FIGO classification, which actually sometimes helps in our guiding management. Usual symptom, we heavy menstrual bleeding, dysmenorrhea, non-cyclic pain, urinary symptom, fatigue, constipation, and sometimes totally asymptomatic. So coming to this background, which is the basic, and this shows a high number of women which are having fibroid, they are coming to only obs gyne. There are no other surgeon or other specialty which can deal with them, and with the few known and few unknown factors. The issue is that this century calls for humanization of medical care, because medical care is now wanted by every society. And now the issue is that it should be humanized, it should be safe, it should be affordable, it should be acceptable, it should be the compassionate. And we have recognized that uterus is not only the organ to harbor the baby and then its role is finished. We now know too very well that the uterus has much more dimension, physiological function in human body, and we have to save the uterus for the woman's health being, as well as for saving ourselves from the people's, like what media hype and the negative remarks from the society. So my first question to Dr. Usha and Dr. Madhubala are that in last decade, what is your perception that incidence of myoma, Dr. Usha is very senior person, incidence of myoma is on rise, it is a real rise or it is a perceptible rise, and how do you find that the people like request that koi dawa to nahi hai, aap कोई दवा दे दीजिए, ऑपरेशन तो नहीं है. सो कमेंट फ्रॉम डॉक्टर उषा शेखावत एंड डॉक्टर मधुबाला चौहान फॉर दिस.
हेलो, आई मैम, उषा मैम प्लीज अनम्यूट.
नो, आई एम अनम्यूटेड.
यस यस यस, यू आर ऑडिबल. यस मैम.
वेल, आई थिंक इन द लास्ट डिकेड इंसिडेंस इज वर्चुअली इंक्रीज्ड, बिकॉज़ एज वी कैन सी दैट मोर एंड मोर पेशेंट्स गो फॉर द sonographies and all as a routine also. So we catch those fibroids, small tiny fibroids also on a sonography, which are lying unsymptomatic, and only if the clinical examination was to be done, they would have been ignored.
But yes,
since we go for a routine sonography and those are, you know, 1.2, 1.7 wala millimeter, 17 millimeter fibroids are also caught on that, and the patient gets, you know, hyped about it. That mere to gaante hain, now what is to be done about it? So they are, you know, constantly on our heads, and they start relating to each and every complaint about it with the concept of their fibroid. One point is that.
Very true, yes, yes.
So I think virtual increase is there. They must have been there also initially, but they were ignored because of the facilities, or other you would say, each and every village has a sonography machine now. So people staying in far off areas also get their USG done. And secondly, the TVS, which has come up into, you know, like more commonly done, that is more sensitive and it catches the fibroid very early.
Dr. Madhubala, thank you very much. Dr. Usha, two very, very important points. Because of routine sonography, people, we are having more and more detection. And the real issue, Dr. Usha, that it is a small myoma seedling, and usually they don't need neither medical nor surgical treatment, but it is really difficult for to reassure them that it's okay. This is also very, very, very important point for in our clinical practice. And Dr. Madhubala, what's your experience that when they come with the report of ultrasound, they request ki koi for the medicine? It is the people's request and the desire that we should have some medical form. Like long ago, when we don't have such drugs, the people used to go for homeopathy treatment. Like we remember, hum homeopathy lete. So Madhubala, your experience about request for the medical management of the fibroid from the patient side.
Dr. Madhubala, आपने हम लोगों को, हमारी सोसाइटी को आपने मौका दिया. Thanks for this. मैं खुद प्रैक्टिस करती हूँ, तो सबसे बड़ी जो पेशेंट को प्रॉब्लम आती है वो पेरिफ्री से स्टार्ट होती है. वहाँ जो डॉक्टर है, इवन कई बार तो जो नर्सिंग स्टाफ है या कि जो भी हेल्थ से रिलेटेड MPW या कोई भी है, वो उसको ये कहेगा जो तेरे को जो भी प्रॉब्लम है ना इसी से रिलेटेड. इवन जो डॉक्टर्स हैं, अच्छे क्वालिफाइड डॉक्टर्स हैं, वो भी कहते हैं कि नहीं, अब जो परेशानी है वो इसी से रिलेटेड है. और वो फिर इस काम के लिए जरूर आएगा कि नहीं, मुझे कुछ तो आपको दवाई देनी है. और मैं हमको यही कहते हैं कि ये जो दवाई है इससे कम नहीं करेगी. हमारा 1 सेंटीमीटर का फुल फाइब्रॉइड है, अब इससे कम अपन इसको क्या करेंगे? ये प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, पर वो काउंसिल नहीं होती है. तो बहुत मुश्किल होता है उसको समझाना ये चीज के लिए कि नहीं, कि तुम्हारे को कोई ट्रीटमेंट की जरूरत नहीं है, तुम फॉलोअप करवा लो. पेशेंट होते हैं 10-20% पेशेंट, दे आर रिस्पॉन्डिंग अवर काउंसलिंग एंड दे गेट रिलीफ विद द our other, she had any problems, so we give the treatment for that problem and she get relief, and then she counsel, and then she told other patients.
Hello.
Can I ask Dr. Sadhana?
Hi. Yes,
like
yes.
You have asked for the approach for surgical versus medical management. Yes, definitely our approach has changed, and we especially looking to what I had earlier said, that we should cater to a fibroid as per the personal criteria, cater to person to person. So depending upon her age, depending upon her requirements, suppose fertility has to be conserved, obviously we should go for medical management. And in the younger age group also, if it has been detected, medical management should be given a trial, conservative management should be given a trial before going on to surgical management.
Thank you, Dr. Usha and Dr. Madhubala. First of all, this is a very common clinical scenario across the country, at least, that people come with the asymptomatic and small myoma, and few like watchful expectancy versus medical and surgical. Now it is our professional expertise, actually what Dr. Usha pointed, that we should individualize the treatment. And thank you very much for this good, very for this start. And we brought in today is what we have in armamentarium: medical options, OCP, progesterone, oral, LNG, IUD, NSAID, tranexamic acid, etiological treatment, GnRH analog, SPRM, and the surgical option, hysterectomy, myomectomy, by laparotomy or by endoscopic approach as per the situation, position, and the non-surgical alternatives are also there, like uterine artery embolization, HIFU, and the fibroid ablation. So the first line option is usually what we say, hum logon ke yahan jo kaha jata hai ki pehla cheez hai jo prevention is the best thing, dusra cheez hai aap lifestyle se usko change kare, what we say satvik, rajasi and tamasi, and the surgery is supposed to be the radical, but of course when surgery is needed, it is also needed. So we have the drawback of the hysterectomy. We know, like we say, the uterus is always like a organ which have a multiple function. So surgical morbidity and anesthesia is cause factor, and the radical final approach, myomectomy, the problem of recurrence, and the technicality of UAE, it is not even available in the Western world for the most of the population. So the change, we have a lot of options. But what is available for our patient, what is agreeable to our patient, and what is beneficial for our patient, that is that this point of discussion for today's all the discussions. So what madam has emphasized already, that the treatment should be individualized, medical therapy to be considered, because surgery is radical with all inherent risks. And there are many evidence, and there are a lot of discussion things like 7 or 10 years that the pharmacological treatment of uterine fibroid should be taken in account. So our next question to Dr. Poornima, if she has joined, and Dr. Urmila Mahala, and we will also come to like any Dr. Fernandez also, because if the Dr. Poornima is there, not there, that coming to medical management, like today we are focusing on medical management. What we used to do around 7 to 10 years ago for abnormal uterine bleeding, we used to give tranexamic acid, NSAID, or the COC. And now we have an option of selective progesterone receptor modulator. So Dr. Urmila and Dr. Fernandez, what's your opinion that how this mifepristone is different from the other drugs like GnRH analog or danazol? How you find that it is better or it is not that better? What's your experience like comparison with the danazol or the GnRH analog or the COC even? So Dr. Urmila and Dr. Poornima, if she is there, she should add, otherwise Dr. Fernandez.
Dr. Farindra, sir, I guess you can continue, because I cannot see Dr. Urmila here right now.
Fine. Very good afternoon, madam. So considering your first question is, how do you perceive the limitation of conventional medical management like COC and progesterone for fibroid? Madam, by pathology, if you go, like nowadays, it is very clear that it is progesterone which is mainly responsible for the growth of the fibroid. Now, pertaining to the management of a patient, it depends upon the how with what complaint the patient has come to you. Suppose if the complaint is pressure symptoms, size of the fibroid, then the treatment line is different. Patient complaining of menorrhagia, heavy menstrual bleeding, then the treatment line is different. You have to first of all see what kind of, and I'm not going into the details of abnormal uterine bleeding, since we have got a palm coin classification which can easily classify the what kind of etiology we are going to need. Now, considering our case, clear-cut case of a fibroid uterus, then the next important thing come is the site of a fibroid, is the location of a fibroid. Now, we have got a wonderful FIGO classification classifying uterine myomas from type 0 to type 7, and the type A is cervical and the parasitic one. So the medical management will not help much in type 0 and type 1, frankly speaking. You can just tide over the situation by giving hormonal treatment, which are either progesterone you can use. If it's not controlling the bleeding, then OCPLs are the wonderful. Yes. Type 2 onwards.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, type please. 2 on.
Huh. Yes, somebody else is taking the
question. No, continue. You please complete yourself, please. Because yeah. I have no, yes.
Yeah. So, because since the question is then again, then GnRH and mifepristone you're asking. So, it again in type 2 to type 5, these drugs have role. Mm-hmm. These drugs have role. Again, type 7, 6 and 7 are less symptomatic. Doesn't make any difference to the patient's mm-hmm. life if they are growing, unless until we are dealing with the pressure symptoms. Way back we used to use GnRH money. Just to one of because there was like articles, it reduces the size, definitely. But it's not the complete treatment. As far as suppose it is less than 3 centimeters, you can slightly reduce the size, you can just stop the growth of a fibroid. But these patients have, since it is a monoclonal tumor, have a tendency they can, you know, again have. But nowadays we have got a wonderful drug, this mifepristone. There was like in the same market time, there was two drugs have come simultaneously. One is mifepristone and uliprostol. Both of them have. Like, there was a big fight between these two drugs. But mifepristone worked wonderfully. Yeah, I'm in a favor of a mifepristone. It's cheap. It's easily available. It gives you a wonderful relief to make the patient amenorrheic. You can buy the time. The size reduces if the myoma size is less than 3 centimeters. This is what I felt in my practice.
Yes.
Big size myoma doesn't make any difference to me in the patients also. And less than 3 centimeters, this drug works wonderfully.
Thank you. I think you have summarized very well, a very well set stage for mifepristone, that is for certain type of tumors. A very, very golden statement is that for certain type of tumors, it really works very well. And what you say for the submucous and the very large fibroid, the surgery is usually the first option. And because it is, Dr. Urmila Mahala, she was not saying, Dr. Aditi comment, I will like to say that GnRH analog, how the, like the mode of pharmacological action, how mifepristone, what Dr. Farendra says that the mifepristone, he finds better than GnRH analog or danazol. So Aditi, a brief comment about the mode of action of mifepristone and why it is a, it is supposed to be a better acceptable drug. Dr. Aditi, please.
Ma'am, as far as GnRH analogs is concerned, there is agonist as well as antagonist are there. When we start with agonist, initial flare up response is there, which we definitely don't want. Ma'am, they produce amenorrhea, they causes decrease in bleeding as well as the size of the myoma also decreases. Mm-hmm. But after stopping the therapy, the rebound occurrence of the rebound, that means the growth of the myoma is of very much concern, mm-hmm. which is not there in mifepristone. Mm-hmm. As it is a antiprogesterone, or earlier when we are residents and we have been taught, and there is the all culprit is thought to be estrogen, but as, the etiology, as we are now better know about the etiology of the fibroid, then estrogen as well as the progesterone is also a culprit. So yes, the role of progesterone, like norethisterone, it is decreasing nowadays in the medical management of fibroid, mm-hmm. because we have to be very cautious when we are using any progesterone for the medical management. We have to be cautious about the size of the fibroid. We have to definitely follow the size, whether it is increasing or not. So mifepristone, as Dr. Farendra already had said, because it is cheap. And one, I think, is a point of concern with mifepristone, definitely the patient who is in reproductive age group and who wants to conceive should be very well counseled about the contraceptive practices during mifepristone treatment.
So, yes, very great. We will come to that. So, thank you, Aditi, for thank you very much, Dr. Farendra and Dr. Aditi. Progesterone, CAC, and the injectable progestin, actually, they are not the treatment of fibroid. They are all cater the symptom of abnormal uterine bleeding, with their own effect, like COC with breakthrough bleeding, injectable MPA with low bundle density, and danazol especially for androgenic effect, and GnRH analog for the menopause, like as well as the adverse effect on the BMI. So Aditi has already said that now the estrogen is not a culprit, it is the progesterone receptor which is supposed to be upregulating EGF and BCL2 expression, and now we have a selective progesterone receptor modulator because they act through the suppression of expression of progesterone gene. It is same with fibroid, it is same with the breast cancer, that we now understand that progesterone also plays a role in all these neoplastic behavior. What we say that it is not only estrogen, what Aditi says, and the estrogen reducing, why GnRH come into the picture, because it was anti-estrogenic. But PRS receptor, but because of very severe side effect, as well as for the cost factor, as well as the injectable issue, GnRH analog has, like now, because we have a good option of the mifepristone, they have taken a vaccine. So again, emphasizing that fibroid overexpress estrogen and progesterone receptor, and that's why many, many textbooks actually say that the selective progesterone receptor modulator are a drug of choice for the medical management of fibroid whenever it is indicated. This slide also emphasizes the same thing, that the what progesterone believed to be physiological regulator of uterine fibroid growth, so increased BCL2 protein expression leading to inhibiting apoptosis, increased EGF expression, and decreased TNF-alpha expression. So there are many new things which we are actually do in research setting, but main thing is that the progesterone and progesterone receptor are important target tissue where the selective progesterone receptor modulator like mifepristone is acting on the fibroid inhibition and the reduction in the growth as well. So they are the new class of progesterone receptor ligand which display tissue selective agonist, antagonist and misactivity on the target cells. And what GnRH analog cause? It is menopausal flushes, it is hot flushes, markedly reduces estrogen level after GnRH analog. But when we use vasopressin, there is a not that much that much decrease of estrogen, so the patient acceptance is good. And it has a direct action on fibroid, direct action on endometrium, as well as direct action on pituitary. So it reduces the fibroid size, it stops uterine bleeding, it results in benign and reversible change. We will talk about it. And by action on the pituitary, it causes anamenorrhea by inducing, inhibiting ovulation and maintaining mid-follicular phase level of estradiol. So this is very, very important that the vasopressin maintain the estrogen level. So the acceptance rate is much high and the adverse effect and the side effects are much less. So this is the thing, because we as a professional prescribe the drugs, and we should take this opportunity to understand what drug we are prescribing and how it is affecting the our, like how we know about everything, every aspect, right from the cause to the acceptability and the mode of action. So it is now considered as effective as GnRH analog, no effect on BMD, lesser side effect, oral route of administration, which our patient always wants. It allowed trying to correct anemia and planned surgery at the lesser recurrence than GnRH analog and improves health related quality of life. So I think all the panelists have taken this this message to all the audience, and this is the first SPRM. Actually, it was Dr. Alka Kriplani when she was in 2014, she started work on the indigenous by breaking the tablet into syrup and working on the 10 milligram vasopressin when this prescription was not available. And the few of the studies, initial studies, are from India, because in India, really, they have the demand for the medical trials. So one comment about vasopressin. Dr. Farid, you talked about vasopressin. And we had a lot of trial, and suddenly the drug is come out of the market. It is also SPRM. So Dr. Parin, we will start from you. We will have your comment about the why vasopressin is not available, and your any personal experience or any side effect of vasopressin as compared to vasopressin. So Dr. Parin and then Dr. Usha, we will have like to have your expert comment on it.
When these drugs have come into the market, almost there was a lot of competition between the vasopressin and vasopressin. Frankly speaking, every clinician was using both the drugs, let me say. Yes. Most of them. They see vasopressin was expensive drug, vasopressin was relatively cheaper drug.
Hmm.
There was a lot of market that, you have to do, before starting, you have to do liver marker test. Then again, monthly, you do liver marker test. Madam, in my small experience, time, I have not seen very few patients. Recently I'm having one patient who is on vasopressin, and shows the moment I start vasopressin, she shows rise in SGOT and SGPT.
Mm-hmm.
Only total 3 or 4 patients I've seen with vasopressin. I've not seen a single patient when I was using vasopressin SGPT. I cannot say, because I'm dealing more of a surgical patient rather than medical management.
Mm-hmm.
But I was very comfortable with the vasopressin acetate. And the same way I'm comfortable with vasopressin. I've not seen much side effect into the patient. In both the lines, patient was very comfortable, tolerating the drug, and showing a decent reduction in the size, at least the shape gets changed. The symptomatically, they get better. So for me, there was no difference as far as the clinical point of view.
Thank you, Dr. Farinda, because it is same. Liver derangement is not that common with vasopressin. Thank you very much for it, because there has been a rare report of the acute liver injury. Very, very rare reports, but it has actually pressurized in COVID time. There were an issue from medical fraternity that medical options should be available, especially in COVID times when we were deferring the all gynae routine surgeries because of reducing hospital load. So thank you, Dr. Parin. Your experience was wonderful, and I think it matches with all the evidence what is available. Dr. Usha, your comment about the vasopressin and as compared to SPRM. Yes.
I totally agree with Dr. Farinder, that as far as I have been using vasopressin, there was no side effects in my patients, as we have seen, and on the conservative management, but mostly like we were dealing with patients with infertility. I was in the reproductive medicine department that time. So at that time, we were, you know, more keen to get them on a, if the it was affecting the fertility, to get a myomectomy done and put them on the fertility treatment rather. So we did not use the conservative management much on that, because if that was affecting it, otherwise we would proceeding with them. But seeing, talking about the side effects, I have not noticed, not in a single patient did I notice a derangement in the liver functions when we are following them. Although I definitely agree that it was an expensive treatment and they needed repeated checkups for their the liver functions. But I did not notice any in my patient.
Thank you. I think Dr. Farinda, Dr. Usha, and we all are on the same page. And PERL 3, PERL 4 trial also says that it is a very rare event with the liver injury, though it is a costly drug. And at present, there is a question mark about the uliprostol, and the metoprostol is the thing which is the cheaper as well, and which is considered to be safer as well. So all the world is going for the SPRMs in the management of uterine fibroid. These are the few very, very recent research paper from 2020 and 2021. And biomedical treatment, we will just go now to the case situation, because we want to have these aim, improving hematological status, reducing size of fibroid, so that we can have minimal excess surgery, avoid surgery totally, extending preoperative time, and providing non-surgical options. I will share few evidence. I think Dr. Farin, Dr. Usha, we have all shared your experience, and it totally matches with the experience. We have a lot of paper, global as well as Indian, which recommend that the low-dose mifepristone is a very good drug for the fibroid. This is Dr. Alka Kriplani, what we say, she is a wonderful person. I was fortunate to be her vice president, a very, very research-minded person, honored by, and she had a, what we say, she so long ago, she shared with me, ki hum log usko के अंदर सिरप बना के देते हैं, एंड वन ऑफ द वेरी वेल साइटेड पेपर डॉक्टर अलका कृपलानी दैट इट हेल्प्स इन द एयूबी व्हाट वी से मेनी मेनी जर्नल्स एडवोकेट द यूज ऑफ मिसिप्रिस्टोन एंड द सेलेक्टिव प्रोजेस्टेरोन रिसेप्टर मॉड्यूलेटर एंड दीज आर ऑल स्टडीज आई विल गो वेरी क्विकली इट इज स्टडी फ्रॉम 2012 फ्रॉम प्रिस्टन इन द 112 participants that it improved the fibroid specific quality of life. Today the world is acting, it is the quality of life, and it can be health related and it can be the emotional related issue, emotional related quality. So I think the metoprostol is a drug which actually accept health related as well as the overall quality, emotional and everything reduction. So these are few very important papers from Jody Stenner, which shows amenorrhea, reduction on myoma, reduction of uterine volume, and a very good Indian paper also. And Indian mind is always innovative. Unfortunately, we have a less presence in the publication world. And this is one issue which we are going to have together, that a wonderful academician all over the country. What we are having, we must have our presence. And this is a study from Dr. Manjula for 100 asymptomatic patients. And it is, says that it is as effective as GnRH agonist and better tolerated than GnRH antagonist. It is again one study on the 25 milligram, and the two studies are which compare from the GnRH analog. And what Dr. every panelist says that it is much better accepted and this thing, and it is safe drug. And it is again a study from the Dr. Geeta Prasad that the 25 milligram mifepristone reduce volume as well as the abnormal uterine bleeding and acceptable. One few paper, this was the same paper, and one few paper which I want to quote, which compare 10 milligram and 25 milligram fibroid. And we will say just to the panelists to this question that the why when you consider 10 milligram and when you consider 25 milligram. This is one question. And the endometrial histopathology is also safe after use of mifepristone, what the study says. What we say, low dose mifepristone, we will just share with in the next case situation that when you consider 10 milligram at versus as compared to 25 milligram. But the study says that the low dose mifepristone is almost as effective as the 25 milligram dosage. And one very good paper, this was a case report, like in a very high risk situation, very large fibroid, and this patient was presented as just the ICOG 2020, that a very high risk and unwilling for surgery, the mifepristone can be considered as a safe alternative because we have the time to improve the hematological status. And this is again the same, the studies in the continuation, which is the Indian studies, and why the women respond differently in different ethnic groups. And that's why the Indian studies are very, very important. They actually support our confidence in any management strategy. And again, it is a 10 milligram and 25 milligram, which shows that the AUB is decreased by 24.8% and 84.2% attain amenorrhea. And in our group, patients many times welcome with AUB amenorrhea. They are not much bothered about it because it suddenly did like improve the quality of life. And one very good paper was saying that the it was only one study that was 50 milligram once a week. So that is also a one thing. And Dr. Deepa's paper that 50 milligram once a week, that is Sunday to Sunday, two tablets of mifepristone, and she has found very effective alternative. So I don't have this experience, but it is also a very good acceptable pattern. So coming to with this strong evidence, it is time for individualization, and only our experience says it. So this is a 20-year-old girl, and she is in third year BTech student, and she comes with, again, a little heavy menstrual bleeding, tolerable but significant dysmenorrhea, sometimes lower abdominal pain. And she has ultrasound report, two interstitial fibroid, 12 by 14, 10 into 12, one ovary cystic and large echogenic endometrial cavity normal. Very, very anxious. She has not married, campus placement is due, and she is having heavy menstrual bleeding and very, very anxious. So question two, again, we'd say, Dr. I think we have taken Dr. Madhupala. And then Dr. Pritam Kothari, she is there because for Dr. Farinda, then we will come to Dr. Farinda for especially when he considers surgery. So Dr. Madhubala, your comment on such a very, very common situation, adolescent girl, two with small myoma, a little symptomatic. Yes. Doctor, yes.
First of all, counseling is important as she is having fibroids and though size is very small, so we tell her about the medical management so that she is ready, and also the, her parents were also ready, just they doesn't want, first is a marital status and the, what is her obstetric history, so these factors are also considered to the family, and then medical management is first line of drug, and mifepristone is a also give good result, and I have experience with the mifepristone also, 25 and 10, both are giving good result, and in 3 months the size is usually reduced by around 50%.
So thank you, Dr. Madhubala. Dr. Pritam has joined Khushbu, and then we will come. Dr. Pritam Kothari is there. Can we have her comment, and then we come to again Dr. Farendra or Dr. Urmila, anybody who have not spoken. So in adolescent girl, you say medical management, in this small fibroid, can you, we have the watchful expectancy, or you want to, like she has come with the heavy menstrual bleeding a little bit and the two interstitial myoma. Do you think there can be other cause of
it? Madam, to me, this patient, she's a very young girl and comes with the complaints of dysmenorrhea as well as heavy menstrual bleeding. Now, a young girl with dysmenorrhea and heavy menstrual bleeding with ultrasound showing a very small fibroid, I would say I would like to go into the details of dysmenorrhea and would definitely consider having endometriosis along with adenomyosis in this patient.
Yes.
See, rather than targeting my treatment towards the fibroid, which is ultrasonographic finding, not favoring my clinical diagnosis, I would really evaluate and give her a treatment, probably give her a treatment of, if she's not sexually active, PID. If she's active, if not, then considering the endometriosis and give her a ovulation suppression using dinoglucose contraceptive pills and give a trial of a drug and see whether she's improving her symptom or not.
Yes. Yes, yes. Thank you very much. I think COC is the first thing we can try for it. And what you say, we have to do the full evaluation because there may be thyroid dysfunction. There can
this
be anemia.
Very small, will not cause that
thyroid, yes. So other issue, there can be thyroid dysfunction and very rightly the pelvic inflammatory disease, which is now a very, very common issue we associated with BUB. So we have to take these girls as a DUB and never consider that only myoma can or causing all the issue. So very, very rightly said that the proper evaluation and the proper first line drug and with the counseling, we can start with either first COC and see what happens. And then, of course, the selective progesterone receptor modulator, mifepristone, is always there. Dr. Urmila is there. She had the comment or the doctor?
She is here, ma'am. She has joined. Dr. Urmila.
So, Dr. Urmila, your comment is adolescent myoma, small myoma with a little symptom, with mild symptom. Dr. Urmila, please.
Sorry, ma'am. Repeat the question. I just joined now.
So it was an adolescent girl, not adolescent, actually 20-year-old drug, B-Tech student, and she has a heavy menstrual bleeding, a little bit mild dysmenorrhea, mild lower abdominal pain, and she has a report of 2 interstitial fibroid, 1 ovary cystic enlarged and echogenic, and endometrial cavity normal. So what you say that how you very, very anxious that are tumor hai, ab ye ho jayega, abhi to ye bhi nahi hua hai, ye bhi nahi hua hai. So you know these girls today. So and your takeaway for the management.
Her age is married, the young girl. So we counseling her about this this problem is that the fibroid is never a malignant. Chances there is getting chances about them.
Yes.
After that we outline the management line. If the patient is young and unmarried, we first of all we try to regulate the menstrual bleeding by the either non-hormonal treatment, NSAIDs, like antifibrillating drugs, tranexamic acid. If she not respond, then we can take her on the hormonal treatment. And counseling is the important part in this patient.
Very, very rightly said. Actually, what we want to say, that always reassure that the fibroid has been almost no potential of getting malignant, especially in this age group. And very, very nicely said that the PID, UTI, good imaging pattern, and always consider what Dr. Farid emphasized, we have to consider associated pathology like endometriosis and adenomyosis. So we have to take the full picture before we resort to any treatment. And these are few new professional recent updated recommendations that it is only ultrasound which is recommended as initial imaging modality. It is a one another issue which actually puzzles me that the people write MRI at a, like a just blink of eye. And ultrasound, 3D, TVS, good color Doppler actually gives you every information. I can say more information than MRI. And it is a real, I think, a quite wastage of patients' money. And what Dr. Urmila emphasized very, very right, golden word, that the expectant management is appropriate for women with asymptomatic uterine fibroid. And we have to give the relief of sign and symptom, reduction of size of fibroid. We have to conserve fertility and no heart. So the GnRH analog is not a good choice. So question 4 to Dr. Shabdika and Dr. Aditi. What you find that SPRM, what Dr. Farindra and Dr. Urmila has set the stage, what is the extra advantage of SPRM over other drugs like GnRH analog or COC in these situation in a young girls, especially in consideration of the young girls? So Dr. Shabdika and Dr. Aditi, can you comment on it, brief comment on it?
Yeah, ma'am, as we have already seen that mifepristone is much cheaper than the GnRH analogs. And the side effect, the hypoestrogenic phase, which is going to be developed along with the GnRH analog, we can avoid if we use mifepristone in it. Basically, in this situation, if the patient is having mild symptoms, mild heavy menstrual bleeding along with dysmenorrhea, as Dr. Urmila has said, that first of all, we should think about the non-hormonal treatment. If they are not relieving the symptoms of the patient, then we think about the mifepristone. And I think in this scenario, mifepristone will be the gold standard. We can also use ulipristal, but so small fibroids are there. I think they are not causing any symptoms in the patient. That heavy menstrual bleeding may be due to some other cause, like PCOS yes. and other things, which Dr. Farind has also said, endometriosis, like etiology may be there. In that case, low-dose OCPs may be a choice to treat the symptoms of the patient.
So I think, thank you very much for it. So the short-term COC can be used to improve heavy menstrual bleeding associated with fibroid primarily, though through their suppressive effect on the endometrial proliferation, but actually they have no effect on uterine fibroid. But they can give the predictable predictable menstrual pattern as well as the less amount of bleeding symptomatic relief. So COC can be a good choice to start with, but if it is not effective, if they are not very having the reduction in the symptom or improved symptom, then mifepristone is also a very good choice. GnRH analog, it not only the side effect, especially in the young women, we don't want to give because it has a real reduction in the bone mineral density. And to start with, besides COC, we can also use the tranexamic and NSAID for the dysmenorrhea and for the heavy menstrual bleeding. So one comment from, I think you will take Dr. Urmila and Dr. Preetam Kothari, if she's there. That when you prescribe the drug, how do you prescribe the drug? In what phase after menstruation or any time in the cycle? Any instruction about the mifepristone prescription?
Like adolescent female, we can prescribe it anytime. There is only if married and we are suspecting that some pregnancy should may be there. Then we are worried when prescribing after menses. Otherwise, we can prescribe it anytime.
Thank you very much for it. So one very important thing is that if she is married, then we can have it in the mid cycle. It will not affect ovulation, and there can be chance of conception. So in this girl, if you are sure that she cannot be pregnant or something, then you should start. You can start anytime. Otherwise, usual preferred is the first to seven day of menstrual cycle. Should be taken on same time every day, like progesterone. We should be a little bit cautious about it. And once daily after food, and minimum treatment duration should be 3 to 6 months. Like in 1 or 2 months, you will don't have that desirable effect. And we will go ahead with this question with the sharing that the 10 milligram is as effective as 25 milligram mifepristone and comparable to GnRH analog. It is from our own journal, Journal OB-GYN India, and which is the different doses of mifepristone has got the good effect. So low dose mifepristone has come in a big way. Dr. Usha, will you like to share your comment? When you prescribe, how do you cater that this patient I will write 10 and this patient the 25 is good enough? So Dr. Usha, for your expert comment.
She'll just come back in 10 minutes. She's yet not here now.
Achai, then I think Dr. Preetam Kothari and Dr. Shabdika can add to it. How you take the 10 milligram and 20 milligram?
Actually, when size is smaller, we can go for 10 milligram, but mostly we prescribe 25 milligram only.
So your choice upon the weight of the patient also. One is the fibroid volume, and the second is any concern. Aditi, any concern about the weight of the patient that you say that it's my 25 dete, and any choice for it? Aditi, your comment.
Ma'am, actually, we are also prescribing the 25 mg dose only. We are not going with 10 mg at present. And yes, we can consider definitely the BMI of the patient in selecting the dose, whether we should use 10 or 25. If the patient is obese, we should go for 25 milligram of mifepristone.
So I think we should
add something?
Yes, Dr.
Farid. Madam, in my practice, I've never prescribed 25. I'm always going with the 10 mg tablet.
Great.
I'm getting a decent result. I thought if the patient is not responding with 10, I may increase. One thing that was in my mind when I used to start this drug. Second thing is BMI. See, the more the BMI increases, the patient became obese. Mm-hmm. And in obese patient, you have got a tendency of having a fatty liver.
Mm-hmm.
So when this drug was started, it was there that it is affecting the liver. You know, you can have a hepatitis out of a picture. Later on, you can develop fibrosis. So in fact, the more obese patient, the more fatty liver chances are there. Then this was my thought that I will give a 10 mg and let me see if the effects are, if I am not getting effect, I may consider something else or give 25. But I've always got the effect with 10 mg. I've never tried 25 mg.
Thank you, Dr. Farid. Actually, you have raised up a very, very important experience. One thing is what paper says, first 25 and then a break for 2 or 3 months and then 10 milligram. But you have taken the thing otherwise. Start with 10 milligram and you observe it, and if it is not and the patient wants medical treatment or the situation warrants medical treatment, then go for 25. And the secondly, the other way around, because obese patient had got the fatty liver, and it is better to give the low dose because the metoprolol is actually working on receptor and it is not related to weight. So thank you, Dr. Farid. I think it was a wonderful input and wonderful new insight in the use of metoprolol. And thank you very much for it. And again, what we say, Dr. Aditya, I think Dr. Madhubala says we have to reassure that we have to allay the fear that the myoma usually does not grow so much. So one rapid fire, Dr. Usha is not there. Dr. Madhubala, you can take. She is the same 27 years, Nalli Gravida, and she has been diagnosed with massive fibroid distorting uterine architecture. And hemoglobin is 7 gram, and it is a big fibroid. So Dr. Madhu, you want to do surgery, or you want to give medical treatment before surgery? If you want to give medical treatment, what is your choice of drug? So it is in the quick discussion about the use of Dr. Madhubala and Dr. Purnima, or Dr. Urmila, you can, Dr. Urmila Mahala, please.
Main ek apna case share karna chahungi.
Haan, bilkul, bilkul. That's why we are here, yes.
Uski bhi around 27 year ki thi, uske second gravida thi, first baby uska alive tha. और वो पेशेंट के मल्टीपल दूसरी प्रॉब्लम और एसोसिएटेड थी, मल्टीपल स्प्लीनिंग इनफार्क्ट थे और कार्डियक प्रॉब्लम भी थी. 20 वीक की वो भी एनीमिक, मतलब उसको हमने करीबन 7-8 यूनिट ब्लड ट्रांसफ्यूज किए थे तब. हाँ, उसका ब्लड हीमोग्लोबिन 9 बड़ी मुश्किल से आया था. अब यही था कि सब जगह से कार्डियोलॉजिस्ट से ओपिनियन ली, गैस्ट्रोलॉजिस्ट से ओपिनियन ली, फिजिशियन से ओपिनियन ली, सबने कहा मैडम अभी तो आप रुक जाओ, हमने वो कुछ नहीं करना है इसका. तब हम लोगों ने नहीं सोच पाए थे क्योंकि फ्री ऑफ मेडिसिन में बैठे हुए हैं, कई बार तो बड़ी मुश्किल होती है कि ड्रग कैसे दी जाए पेशेंट को. हॉस्पिटल सप्लाई में GNR एनालॉग था, वो उसको मैंने लगा के उसको 3 मंथ के लिए भेजा. ये तब तक एनोक्सापेरिन तेरा कंटिन्यू रख, और फिर आफ्टर 1 मंथ वो वापस पेशेंट हमारे पास में आ गई क्योंकि 3 मंथ तक भी वो वेट नहीं कर पाई और वापस उसको प्रॉब्लम हुई. तो सेकेंड टाइम पे हमने फिर उसको आराम से ऑपरेट करा और पेशेंट का आउटकम अच्छा रहा.
So I think you would say that in the build-up, because these huge fibroid usually they are not like respond to medical treatment, yes, but in the building up, the medical treatment, be it GNRH analog or metoprolol, has a very good use. And I think along with the built-up, like what we say, hematinic, maybe FCM infusion, that also gave a little bit backup of the blood transfusion. So this was the takeaway that a medical, when in the surgical case also the medical treatment has got its definite role, and when these patients who are nutritionally deficient, they will having if iron deficiency, then they must be having the calcium, vitamin D3, every deficiency, and if mifepristone is workable for them for producing amenorrhea for 2 to 3 months, then the GnRH analog adverse side effect on the BMD also can be avoided. This is again a second rapid fire.
Ma'am, I wanted to share something.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, I had encountered 2 cases where we had to wait for blood transfusion and anesthetist fitness, and then we were supposed to operate. So with GnRH agonist, especially with the depot, I felt that the surgical planes were not very well located. On the other hand, with the mifepristone, we could operate and the myoma could easily be enucleated, because in this case, myomectomy needs to be done in young patients with a fibroid. So experience with mifepristone was better as compared to the GnRH agonist.
Thank you very much. It is a very important issue, because with GnRH analogs, we actually don't find the plane when you come to myomectomy. So, Dr. Parindra, you are an endoscopic surgeon. We also want to comment on this very, very important point raised by Dr.
Madam, can I add into the previous case?
I'm already coming to you. Yes, Dr. Parindra.
Thank you. Madam, now this lady, she is young, 27. Having a 22 weeks of fibroid. Now this fibroid is, she must be carrying since years. Now she has got an anemia and heavy bleeding now. So when we go for evaluation of such type of cases, you may miss some fibroids which are close to the myoma, endometrial lining, that is some mucosal myoma or other myomas. You may not be able to see on ultrasound. So in the such cases, MRI evaluation to rule out other myomas which are close to the endometrial cavities is very important. Many times, madam, we have seen that even on MRI, you may not be able to see this type of close myomas. So yes, medical treatment is required to build up the hemoglobin, surgery is required, but for evaluation, endometrial lining visualization is important to see other myomas, and during the surgery, hysteroscopy is very important, even if you are dealing with a single big myoma.
Yes, so your point is well taken, because the probe actually does not cover a big myoma.
Yes,
and sometimes we are not able to see the endometrium. Sometimes the TVS help you in endometrium, and MRI, you rightly said, sometimes it helps and sometimes it actually does not add to our info.
Does not add.
So what should we, and we might not leave to fibroid mapping before surgery is very, very important.
Yeah, and looks like 22 weeks big myomas.
So the leuprolide and mifepristone, both, and the mifepristone is again what we say, that it has a no effect on the BMD, and that's why it can be preferred sometimes. And this is another rapid fire 26-year-old unmarried. She's the one point which we are coming up with and want your opinion. She is sexually active. She is AUB with dysmenorrhea. Cannot, like, not very regularly take COC. PID treatment given twice. So she is having already PID. And there is a one intramural pushing myoma, which is pushing endometrial cavity 5/6. So again, in these sort of situation, one thing I want to take up, one aspect of mifepristone, that what do you find if the patient is sexually active? She is already having PID. Does the mifepristone will have a contraceptive role as well, or you have to give up the additional contraceptive barrier or something or something? So Dr. Purnima and Dr. Urmila Mahala, for the contraceptive option, if you are giving mifepristone and patient comes with pregnancy, or she cannot come with pregnancy. Dr. Urmila and Dr. Purnima, if she is there.
In this case, we choose the mifepristone.
Hello, am I on?
Mifepristone can also act as a contraceptive for the conception. By the mifepristone changes, the changes are progesterone receptor modulator associated endometrial changes are there in these cases.
So what we say that the patient, if especially if she starts from the mid-follicular phase, that in such sort of girls, we have to prescribe the contraception and the condom contraception, but the barrier contraception is very, very important. So it is not only that we are discussing, not only the mifepristone or SPRM, actually we are dealing with the overall situation. So we have to take this opportunity. She is having PID, she is having abnormal uterine bleeding, and she has a like risk of pregnancy. So we have to counsel for the double contraceptive, and the barrier contraception has to be added. So
ma'am, in the previous case, as we have seen the history of the patient, she is taking emergency contraception 6 to 8 times, and she is also having PID. So we can see the compliance of the patient regarding the hormonal contraception is not so good. Her standing, maybe the AUB, because of this hormonal contraception, emergency contraception, she is taking so frequently. So we have to counsel the patient about the use the emergency contraception. They are all right if they are taking once a while, but it should not be taken as a habitual practice. So she should use, as you have said rightly, that she should definitely use the dual contraception, barrier contraception along with the hormonal, if she is may tolerate then.
So there is again a one scope for the research that the mifepristone, how it is like the uliprostol was sometimes advocated for the emergency contraception, and mifepristone contraceptive effect, we don't, I and didn't find many important papers, and we'll say the Ecumenist people also to collect data about its contraceptive effect, but taken overall situation with the all high risk situation for a like a not a very like compromised sexual life or we can healthy, so we have to prescribe the barrier contraception for sure. So coming to Dr. Parinda and Dr. Preetam, that 25-year-old girl, she is old woman, she is infertile, and in routine TVS it was found that there was one subserous myoma 30x35 and one interstitial myoma. Dr. Parin and Dr. Preetam, how you take this infertility with accidentally found myoma? So what your takeaway for it is fibroid cause fertility or infertility, yes, or what you, how do you manage? Yes.
Like in infertile patient, if we are finding interstitial or intramural fibroid, which is very small, it is not distorting endometrial cavity, mm-hmm, and subserous myoma at all, it is not going to cause infertility. Mm-hmm. We can keep her on, we can go for the treatment for the infertility only, and we can keep the myoma under observation only.
So thank you very much, Dr. Preetam, for it, because patient is always very no conception, why fever, bada to nahi ho jayega cancer. So again, like adolescent, we have to be compassionate, we have to be comforting that it is not so that every fibroid or the fibroid causes infertility, and we should go ahead with the routine infertility treatment. Thank you very much for Dr. Preetam Kothari for that. And what is the psychological aspect which we have to like care, that what are their worries, malignancy, surgery to nahi hogi, agar फाइब्रॉइड है तो क्या होगा और सर्जरी करेंगे, व्हेन यू से दैट अच्छा सर्जरी करा लो तो कहेंगे सर्जरी से कुछ नुकसान तो नहीं होगा, एंड एक्चुअली वी आर नॉट इन पोजीशन टू आंसर एनीथिंग. सो डॉक्टर फर्नांडिस, योर कमेंट दैट हाउ यू टेक अवे दिस सिचुएशन, हर जना जब आपसे सर्जरी कराने आएगी वो कहेगी तो इससे अच्छा होगा और इससे कुछ खराब तो नहीं हो जाएगा, तो डू यू हैव आंसर्स फॉर ऑल दीस क्वेश्चन डॉक्टर फर्नांडिस?
मैडम, pertaining to this case, 25-year-old, married since 1 year, main usko, of course, I will go with routine evaluation. I may ask for HSG. I may ask for husband semen analysis. May consider her ovulation study. See thing. But for myoma, I will definitely counsel her, provided everything is normal. I will counsel her, यदि आपका सर्जरी करेंगे तो नुकसान होएगा. हो सकता है. सर्जरी करेंगे तो नुकसान हो सकता है. लेट मी सी इफ यू कैन नॉट बिकम प्रेग्नेंट इन स्पाइट ऑफ गिविंग यू नो कंट्रोल ओवेरियन स्टिमुलेशन ऑब्जर्विंग यू, देन वी मे थिंक ऑफ समथिंग एल्स फॉर योर इनफर्टिलिटी. बट अगेन, रिमूविंग द मायोमा इज समथिंग डिबेटेबल एट दिस स्टेज.
So because it can cause actually heart, what are their concern? Yes. Because hysteroscopic myomectomy can also cause the Escherman. Yes. And is a damage a little bit. So we actually don't know that how fibroid contributes to infertility. And in many women, why we are doing a lot of cesarean myomectomy? Because women are pregnant with the fibroid so many, yes, times. So actually we don't know the link between fibroid and infertility. And it is better that we give the patient two chance on the routine infertility treatment and thing. And if the patient is not conceiving or sometime recurrent IVF failure, then we can think that yes, this a woman might need surgery. So in surgery, when these sort of patients come, interstitial myoma, sometimes heavy menstrual bleeding as well as infertility, is there any role in one is the follow up with the infertility treatment? One is the, if we want sometime surgery in between, is there any role for medical treatment as well? That medical treatment wait and let's do what to do the patient conceives, it's okay. If it doesn't conceive, we can think of surgery. So that dilemma situation is so Dr. Shabdika and is Dr. Aditi, your comment on this thing, any role of medical treatment in these infertile women, in women with fibroids?
Ma'am, if we evaluate the patient for infertility, if there is anything else which can cause infertility in that particular couple, then we have to treat that etiology first. And we should not blame the myomas for infertility. Oh, right. Yes. If we are not finding anything that is causing the infertility, then we can go for medical management of myoma and go for the improvement of her fertility.
So I think this is, you are on the page with the FIGO. And FIGO, even for the non-cavity distorting subcutaneous myoma, also says that you can go for the medical management and see what happens and again try for the infertility treatment. And even in the myoma, which is submucous myoma, they say that give the this thing, medical management comes because we can do a more easy hysteroscopic myomectomy, or it sometimes helps in the like invasive, like from the open laparotomy to the laparoscopic or from the laparoscopic to hysteroscopic. So your final comment for Dr. Farinda as the endoscopic surgeon, that medical management sometimes help you in like changing your access to the surgery, that is one role. And secondly, it might help because fibroid is reduced and now the patient can like respond better to the medical management. So Dr. Farinda, your comment for it.
Madam, with the medical management, there is a necrosis, the fibroids will become very soft. And it makes us slightly, you know, make us difficult to retrieve at the time of enucleation. But as an endoscopic surgeon, we are nowadays, we have assumed that, you know, most of the patients take medical treatment when they come for the surgery. So nowadays we are dealing more of a degenerative fibroid, more of a, I mean, this type of picture. So of course it makes a, previously we used to just put a myoma screw and the fibroid just pop out easily. Nowadays we have to use other instrument like tenaculum and all, and you know, dissect them to just enucleate them, degenerative fibroid. Yes, it makes difference with us, but we have adopted ourselves to do these type of myomas.
So one thing is that the plane and what the, yeah. I think Dr. Urmila was saying that the with
yes, yes. There, it is less, there, madam. It
less,
is there.
Less, and the with GNR analog, it was more. So like if cavity is normal, patient should wait. If cavity is disturbed, then we can take for 2 to 3 months of GNR analog, follow up with imaging. Actually, Western world, which was like advocating surgery for everything, endometriosis, repeat surgery. Suddenly, we have taken a back page because we have come to know with the experience that surgery also caused the hidden and the like damage to the endometrium, to the tubal, to the blood supply of the ovary. And we should be very cautious before doing surgery and medical management. And sometimes the patient responds. We have seen a few papers that patient was given mifepristone and after 2 to 3 months, they responded better to the routine infertility treatment. So we have to be very clear on, of course, the situation, submucous myoma, we want to operate. Multiple myoma, we have to, like, we can give the medical treatment because, again, multiple myoma are the thing. That thing Dr. Farinda, Dr. Aditi will agree to me and all the panelists that multiple myoma after myomectomy, they have the more chance of recurrence. And when there is more, so when there are multiple myoma, then you can give the medical treatment and see that what is the myoma redirection and then take the option. So in infertility also, it is a very important place. The medical management and the patient may need many times, and the quick resort to surgery is not advisable by even an expert endoscopic surgeon. So coming to Dr. Usha and Dr. Madhubala, this is again a rapid fire. 46-year-old woman comes to you with the complaint of intramenstrual bleeding, and she is using barrier contraception, BP 134-86, and pelvic examination demonstrated slightly enlarged globular uterus with blood in the cavity. So it is a picture around adenomyosis or the small adenomyoma. So in those situations, adenomyosis, what's your the drug of choice, Dr. Usha and Dr. Madhubala? Dr. Usha has joined, Khushbu? Or Dr. Madhubala, yes, Dr. Purnima, anybody can take, or any...
Dr. Usha is here.
Yes. So with adenomyosis and a small adenomyoma, when you are not very sure, what's your drug of choice? You want mifepristone, you want dinosis. What is your takeaway for such situation? Dr. Usha and Dr. Madhubala.
I prefer to give a dinosist.
Okay, yes.
And they do respond to this, especially because in this sort of scenario, the age and all, I think dinosis should be given a try, personally speaking.
I also give sometimes danazole.
Danazole.
Also giving good result.
So danazole is a drug which came with a which helped us a lot of time. And suddenly it has become ki danazole ka naam lena hi lagta hai koi se no. But actually, what I also agree with Dr. Madhu, that Dr. and Dr. Usha, that danazole in certain very resistant type of heavy menstrual.
I did not say danazole. I said dinogest.
Dinogest, acha. Okay. No. But the danazole is also, these are the drugs actually which is...
I don't give danazole.
Dinogest, in the resistant situation, one can have, and the panel opinion is more towards dinogest. But mifepristone is also, because it is like both dinosis as well as the mifepristone, both like act on the selective progesterone receptor modulator. And like we can have some study and the experience for it. I think those duration surveillance we have taken up already. Now, she is a very, very important case. The 42-year-old woman, parathyroid cesarean section, hypertensive, slightly impaired glucose tolerance, controlled on diet and exercise, not pharmacological therapy. She is having heavy and prolonged menstrual bleeding since last 6 months with dull pain in lower abdomen. And on ultrasound, she is small interstitial myoma, endometrial is 13 millimeter thickened. So in this situation, Dr. Purnima and Dr. Urmila, what's your takeaway? How do you investigate and how do you go about these cases?
Ma'am, first of all, we confirm about these findings either by TBS or we can go for MRI. If there is a myoma or very small, three small interstitial myoma, I think they are not a cause of heavy menstrual bleeding. Since the patient is age is 42, and we do the DNC and histopathological examination of endometrium to rule out any pathology as the patient is hypertensive also and diabetic. So first of all, we rule out any endometrial pathology aggravated by these conditions like endometrial carcinoma, these things. After the DNC, we can try on the hormonal or medical treatment. If patient not respond, then we can go for surgery as the patient age is 40.
Any opinion? Very nicely said that these are the situation what we say that conventional teaching is the corpus cordis syndrome. These patients are high risk for the endometrial malignancy. Yes. And we have to confirm the endometrial histopathology. Usually, we will say it is not DNC, it is usually the endometrial aspiration. Endometrial aspiration, DNC is sometimes so very rightly said that don't go to the medical treatment directly because the patient is high risk for the endometrial malignancy. Anybody want to add?
Can't we go for a hysteroscopic guided endometrial?
We can go for the endometrial evaluation, should be a must. And
that small myoma that you are saying may be a suspicious thing. So if you go directly for a hysteroscopy,
so you can go for hysteroscopy also. Dr. Farid, what you say that we say for endometrial aspiration, non-invasive, easy, no anesthesia, nothing. It should be the universal hysteroscopy, 1-point raise, or it can be a good endometrial aspiration and now take the decision further according to histopathology report. So Dr. Farin, universal hysteroscopy versus a routine endometrial aspiration with a simple PIPL. What's your takeaway? And how the endometrial aspiration
The endometrial aspiration is sufficient to rule out malignancy inside the endometrium.
Thank you very much.
Sufficient to rule out the malignancy inside the endometrium. and you may get the histopathology also. These are two things.
Yes.
But to evaluate the cavity, what Dr. Usha Madam is saying, that you know these myomas, exact location, site, the environment of an endometrium can be better delineated with hysteroscopic guidance. So to rule out malignancy, papal is sufficient. You may get histopathology, but hysteroscopic guided biopsy will be a gold standard.
And especially in this patient who is diabetic, who is hypertensive.
Yes, madam. So,
you know, those
hysteroscopic guided.
Iris factors are there.
No, thank you very much. My one thing is sometimes what happens, why I'm taking this very, very important issue, because endometrial aspiration, what we say, we can have the histopathological sample. It is an overall aspiration because we should not defer the endometrial aspiration because we are some, our OB-GYN is not having hysteroscopy or something. So we should not take out confidence from them. But if you have the hysteroscopy and if you think that the endometrial cavity is giving you the dicey picture, then the hysteroscopic guided biopsy as well as the taking, because we sometimes have the multiple polyps and something. Yes. So the evaluation of the cavity is important, but like we should encourage the confidence of every obstetrician and gynecologist that whatever best which is available in all settings should not be deferred, like best should not be come out in the way of good. This is my takeaway for the majority of women. But of course, the hysteroscopic guided biopsy is a very, very good and very, we can say, the complete treatment. What we say, MRI, usually we don't find it. It is a costly affair. No. And we don't.
Costly affair.
So endometrial aspiration.
It doesn't add to your management.
Because I'm adding this thing because our people are not supported by government. They take all the expenses on their own, and as an obstetrician gynecologist of our India, we should be aware of it, and not in our anxiety we should do MRI and CT and everything. So endometrial histopathology is recommended in AUB all women above 40 years, women less than 40 years with high risk factor, family history of cancer, breast, colon, ovary, use of tamoxifen, and AUB which is not responding to medical management. A very, very important message that the endometrial histopathology and the aspiration is a drug of choice. So now coming the cytology, endometrial aspiration report, proliferative phase. Now for this drug, Dr. Farendra and Dr. Peter Kothari, what's your take? You will take it for hysterectomy, ki itna risk factor hai, or you will go for the like mifepristone or the medical management or the LNG IUCD for these patients? Histopathology came out normal.
I would see her, frankly speaking, FSH level. If it is above 15 or 20, you know, I may give her a medical line of management because I assume that she's about to become a menopause.
Yes.
But if it is less than 10, rather than waiting long and, you know, again increasing her morbidity, I would like to operate her now.
Okay. Any difference of opinion? Dr. Usha, Dr. Aditi, sir says that he will confirm menopause, impending menopause. I think, Dr. Parin, a little disagreement, like a little difference of opinion that actually for menopause, we don't have any good biomarker. It is a period of 6 to 10 years. So, Dr. Usha, what's your takeaway? Yes.
Madam, I can consider her family history, like her mother, at what age she has achieved the menopause, her elder sister, at what age she has achieved, are you about to achieve a menopause? Then I may give her a medical management, observe her, and defer the surgery with endometrial aspiration and pap smear I've already done. Now, if I feel like that she is going to menstruate for 52 years of age, already having few myomas, diabetic, hypertensive. No, with the age, these morbidity will increase. You know, her cardiac status will definitely increase. You know, her sugar level may control, may not be able to control. Then operating these patients at early age will be beneficial.
I think the age mentioned for this patient was 42.
42, madam. Yes, that's why, madam.
42. Yeah. Then I think I'd better go for LNG IUCD. And also is a good option to do.
Again, a very, very important point. Actually, it is such a thought-provoking panel is becoming that I am really noting very new dimension about it. One thing about impending menopause, a good way that, let's see. Secondly, the LNG IUCD in multiple myoma. any like it is supposed to be a good thing around menopause, but in multiple myeloma there is also an issue of like expulsion.
In this case, you had mentioned just a small myeloma. That is why I mentioned. Otherwise, if there are multiple, then we would not go for.
So, because sometimes multiple myeloma or the cavity, like a regular, then LNCICD create a problem. And the one thing which we wish to add that the patient compliance. If the patient is not able to come for the regular checkup, then surgery can be thought of easily, but early in the considering high risk case. But if the patient is compliant and she can say she can come for the endometrial evaluation, then we can think of the medical management. So keep all options open. Sometimes patient doesn't want to go to like repeat to the doctor. And in those cases, we can like counsel that, yes, you have the certain high risk factor and if we cannot get done the ultrasound for endometrial thickness and the follow-up, we can consider the this thing, like surgery. So COC, LNG, IUS, GnRH, analog, SPR, and these are the issue available, but it is actually always time what is best for the patient. Agar patient ke ghar mein shaadi hai, kuch economic, kuch final responsibility, examination due, then we can think of the medical management and see what is happening. So it is again a Cochrane review which shows that it improves heavy menstrual bleeding and fibroid specific related quality. And the surgery can be considered in select situations for mucous myoma, multiple myoma, severe AUB causing anemia, AUB not responding to medical treatment, rapidly enlarging myoma. They are really all, these are the myoma which actually give us the doubt for the malignancy potential as well. And they should be taken for the surgery and the complete histopathology. Associated pathologies like comorbidities and patient desire. If patient says that no, it's enough is enough, we should go for the surgery. Surgery has a definite role in the myoma treatment. One question that Shabdika, if you are there, that in myomectomy, I think we have taken a little bit of it. You have done myomectomy, like we say, 23-year-old, and you have removed around 12 myomas. So in what circumstances you think that I have done surgery, no treatment is required, or in some cases you want to give mifepristone so that there is no recurrence, and how you select the use of SPRM in post myomectomy situation? Dr. Aditi and Dr. Shabdika, your opinion, please.
Ma'am, if the myoma is huge and the patient is not fit for the surgery, in those conditions, I would like for first going for a medical management and deferring the surgery, especially myomectomy, and especially if the patients are young, infertile, and the cause of infertility is myoma, then in such cases, myomectomy would be taken. But as far as
my question was also the post-myomectomy, like endometriosis, na, we do surgery and then we put on the dynogest and the GnRH analog or COC with dynogest so that there is no recurrence. Does after surgery also, in some situation, you like to give any medical treatment as well? Post-surgery, post-myomectomy.
Yes, ma'am. Post-myomectomy also, I would like to take the patient on the mifepristone only. I would not take for the patient on GnRH agonist.
Because so all patient or few patient? What I want to say is for all or in certain situations?
No, ma'am, not all the patients, especially with multiple fibroids and some seedling fibroids, we may also miss during the surgery. Post-medical treatment, the seedling fibroids are frequently missed. So they may grow and their nidus may lead to all other fibroids in the follow-up time. So for that, I would like to go for a medical management post-operatively in the myomectomy cases.
Thank you very much. That was a wonderful point you have raised. Actually, one thing that is in multiple myoma, you have removed like 22 myoma. In those patients, actually, really, we have a very high chance of recurrence. And in the girls, they have a long reproductive life ahead. They are not bearing. In those patients, we can think of the medical post-operative management. And very rightly, you have raised that we can miss the myoma seedling. Howsoever we mapping do, howsoever we are doing, whatever way, but sometimes we can miss the small myoma seedling, and that is again common with the multiple myoma. And In that cases, the medical management with Pipistone gives you as in 3 months you can give your check for the again for the good PVS and the abdominal ultrasound, and then you can see. Thank you very much for it. Dr. Usha, you any comment for the post operative medical management? Your experience, Dr. Usha?
एक एक्सपीरियंस शेयर करना चाहूंगी मैडम.
हाँ जरूर जरूर जरूर.
एक 25 ईयर ओल्ड गर्ल अनमैरिड थी और उसके मल्टीपल फाइब्रॉइड, हमने 25 के करीब फाइब्रॉइड उसका और एक लूज फाइब्रॉइड था अराउंड 22 वीक्स का.
हाँ हाँ.
और 22 फाइब्रॉइड्स और वो रिमूव करने के बाद भी सेटलिंग फाइब्रॉइड इतने सारे थे कि हमारे लिए पॉसिबल नहीं था कि उनको और हम. And then after surgery, we had given her Ulipristol as because at that time Ulipristol is the drug of choice.
हाँ हाँ हाँ.
And she had taken for it at least for 3 months. And then after 1 year, she had again came for the recurrence of the fibroid. And now I have put her on the JNR channel.
Okay, really few people really, it will be really have this situation. Dr. Usha, thank you for sharing this experience. Because in some situation, what is the estrogen progesterone receptor and why they have this high tendency for myoma? And for this, the like medical treatment gives us a relief also. Wo abhi surgery hua tha, toh phir kyun ban gaya? So it is sometimes for like saving us for so many questions.
Genetic tendency, uski younger sister ke bhi utna bada fibroid hame remove karaya abhi.
और ये बहुत ट्रिकी सिचुएशंस होती है एंड आई होप इन सच सिचुएशन वी शुड टेक एडवांटेज ऑफ ऑल द ड्रग्स विच आर अवेलेबल एंड विच आर प्रूवन बाय साइंस, क्योंकि हम ही लोग परेशान हो जाते हैं अभी ऑपरेशन हुआ है तो फिर आपने क्या किया. सो इट इज ए गुड चॉइस. अनदर इम्पॉर्टेंट इश्यू विद द SPRM इज दैट शी वाज टेकिंग SPRM, शी हैड एमेनोरिया एंड नाउ अल्ट्रासाउंड फाइंडिंग आफ्टर 3 मंथ यू गेट की चलो अल्ट्रासाउंड करा लो फाइब्रॉइड देखते हैं क्या हुआ. So there was a 25% reduction in size, but the endometrium, what ultrasonologist says, thick and irregular. So your comment on that, this thing that when you read this report of USG, actually what I say that when the Ulipristol was there, actually the pharma people didn't say me anything about it. But after 3 or 4 patient, I said that I always find the endometrium is thickened and what's wrong. Then I inquired again and then we come to report that there can be the change. So your takeaway, Dr. Farindra and Dr. Shabdika, about the this when we do the SPRM, what is the change in endometrium and how we should take it as ultrasonologists, as gynecologists and as pathologists? About the progesterone associated endometrial change, what is said? So your comment about it, Dr. Aditi and Dr. Shabdika. Or anybody can take the question. Anybody can take.
Madam.
Yes, please. Khushbu, please mute, accept the all panelists so that Dr. Farindra, please.
Yes. Since, madam, these patients, when we put them on selective progesterone receptor modulator, we know now the uterus is going to face the unopposed estrogen for at least a period of 3 months. So endometrium is bound to increase.
Yes.
But whatever, and we all know that, yes, we have to give continuously for 3 months, then we have to give a 1 month break, allow the patient to bleed, see the size of a fibroid, evaluate, and then again restart for another 3 cycles, maximum a period of 6 months. Not beyond that, it is not advisable and recommended. So if you are getting a...
Yes, sir. Please complete.
Ma'am, one thing I would like to add.
Yes.
Ma'am, is the Ulipristol and these selective progesterone receptor modulator increase the endometrial thickness and they causes the cystic glandular hyperplasia. To suppress this, we can use the LNG IUCD with the these drugs to decrease the endometrial thickness.
Any comment
along
with actually? Actually, what they say, what they wish to say, thank you very much for this comment, but it is actually the natural thing. When we use the selective progesterone receptor modulator, actually we don't need to give anything else, but anything etc. But we must be aware, gynae imaging person as well as pathologist should be aware of use of SPRM and its effect on endometrium. It is a benign, a little non-physiological, right, non-proliferative histological feature. So we must know, be aware, and we should not like first we give metoprolol, then we give LNG, IUCD, then I think this will be a too much. And Dr. Farinda and Dr. Usha comment for this, that for endometrial changes, we can we use LNG, IUCD, or it is recommended or not recommended?
No, I don't think so, because we should be mentally, you know, clear about it, that these changes are going to occur.
Yes.
And so we can pacify the patient also if she's worried about it, especially nowadays patient look up into the Google and Google searching ke baad mein ye mere ko kyun aa raha hai. So then if we are clear into it, then we can pacify the patient that this is an acceptable side effect of.
So we must be aware of it actually, because I was also not worried when I use Iliprostol, and then we come to know for so many literature, then see it's a normal thing and we don't need any suppression or something. These are the last few one or two cases, very fast, 36-year-old, 36 BMI. Diabetic on oral hypoglycemic agent and AUB with intramural fibroid 6x7, endometrial thickness 7 millimeter. So has been advised hysterectomy. Dr. Shabdika and Dr. Aditya, can you consider a methotrexate for a while or straight away surgery? What's your takeaway on this situation?
Yes, ma'am, we can prescribe her methotrexate definitely, because again, she is having all the high risk factor for that endometrial hyperplasia and malignancies. So after ruling out,
what is the obstetric history?
Paris sterilized.
I think we should go for surgery.
We can go for surgery because a big
problem. And I think Farinda is going to agree with me.
100%, ma'am. 100%. In fact, with this comorbidity, I may consider hysterectomy rather than myomectomy.
No myomectomy.
Yeah. No, madam.
Because
we don't
go for surgery, then definitely surgery should be there.
Yeah, because she is very obese. BMI 36 is very much. It's too much.
She is high risk.
Myomectomy will take more time than obesity, diabetic, hypertension. Hysterectomy is advisable.
Actually, another issue is that beside other thing, because these are the patient for high risk for ovarian tumor, high risk for endometrial malignancy. We have to take the thing that the patient is how compliant is. She is having a lot of comorbidity. So already she is spending a lot on doctors and medicine.
True. So one time
treatment, and at least be sure about the uterus. So again, only for built up or something after assuming malignancies, we can go for the surgery. And this is a 55-year-old woman. I think it is the last question. Heavy and prolonged bleeding. HB 5%, diabetic, hypertensive, not controlled, multiple myoma. But anesthetist fitness is there. So Dr. Usha and Dr. Madhubala, how do you tackle and use of medical management in build up and getting ready this patient for surgery? Dr. Usha and Madhubala.
Ultimately, I think she has to be taken for surgery. So what is the, it is the anemia which is creating a
non-fitness. Diabetic uncontrolled hypertension.
That can all be managed. I think the diabetes can be controlled, and ultimately she has to be taken for surgery.
So with the FCM, with the good control,
these two are factors which can be controlled. Yeah. And she can be made fit.
She had improved and control her
blood. Yes, actually, medical management comes in a role that when she has the 3-month amenorrhea, as well as the 3-month every like physician fitness and anesthetic fitness. So the patient, like the hospital stay will be less. We can manage on the home. And when she comes after 2 to 3 months of methotrexate with the better hemoglobin, with the better diabetes and hypertension,
we can buy time with the medical management and ultimately take a person.
To make her helpful, and that there is no issue of the dissection because we are going to have
that's what I meant by buy time.
She is 55, so she must be a menopausal female.
But she is having multiple myoma, submucous myoma.
But she is continuously bleeding and didn't achieve menopause. Because if it is a postmenopausal bleeding, Then the management is different, madam, slightly.
No, no, she's not postmenopausal.
She is not postmenopausal.
She's delayed menopause.
Delayed menopause. Fine, ma'am.
So we can give time, मतलब like we can have the option like giving like अगर हम इसको घर hospital में रखेंगे हमको 6-7 दिन उसको extra रखना पड़ेगा with blood, with FCM, with diabetes, with physician. Or the second option is that you give that you take opinion of all your physician, get good diet, good like control and the good medical treatment, and you can, if the patient is having amenorrhea or the good hemoglobin after 9 or 10, and we don't want also the blood transfusion etc. also, so we can make up the
bill. Amount of blood and all you are going to give again, she's going to have bleeding if she has any.
So actually what happens with mifepristone is PRM, the patient goes into the amenorrhea. Actually this is the thing, but it is always the option,
but that is not the ultimate. I think only give it for a time being and then surgery is a must.
It is only adjuvant to surgery, but not fit at the moment. That's the issue. So classic surgery and the medicine is not, they are always friends. And pre-treatment in high-risk surgical cases, we can consider, we can change to minimal access surgery. Pre-treatment we can do. And again, if the fibroid is much more than 18 weeks size, the medical treatment does not help us. And again, what is the access? So everyone is your friend in this universe. We are a strong believer in that. And the Rajasthan Society is more so who cater a lot of food tourists from all over the world to the beautiful thing. We are always a friend, and all techniques and all medicines, all our friends. Last experience about the uterine artery embolization. क्या हम देखते हैं कि हर में हम लोगों को जैसे कुछ चीज याद करना है और हमको जरूर बोलना है. And sometimes we say that it actually what I'm bothering about in the academic events that the knowledge cripples you. It doesn't make you confident, but cripples. अच्छा हमारे यहाँ तो ये होता नहीं है. Always having a low self-esteem in India and something. So Dr. Purnima, Dr. Urmila Mahala, UAE. Anybody, if they have any practical experience, please know about. Let us share on the uterine artery embolization. If your institution have this experience, or if any personal experience, please share with us. And how you take away the role of UAE in management of fibroids. Dr. Purmila, Urmila, Dr. Parind, anybody who has any personal experience about it.
I have no experience about this.
Madam,
we have never
in our hospital. Me and Dr. Usha Shekhawat, madam, are working in the same hospital. We have got a intervention radiology department. So yes, we offer uterine artery embolization, but not to a fibroid. I mean, actually, I have not offered to a fibroid, but for AV malformation, yes, we have gone through this procedure. Yes. And it's a wonderful procedure for AV malformation because their other treatment modality doesn't work. But not for fibroid. I have no experience of fibroid.
So thank you very much. So we say Dr. Usha and Dr. Farindra have the experience, very fortunate, because most of the institutions that it has been used, but the pregnancy, active infection, suspension of any malignancy or absolute contraindication. We don't know after UAE what will be the outcome in form of fertility. Post-embolization syndrome is there. Chronic pain, ovarian and menstrual dysfunction are common side effects. And we don't know what is outcome for the infertility. So very rightly said that AV malformation, it must be effective because it is focusing on one thing. And the issue is that even the Western world says, what to say of UAE, it is the developed world says that even the minimal access hysterectomy, minimal access endoscopic surgery is not available to a large group of population. So the right use of the medical management, right use of the surgery at the right time, and if we have the technique, we can use it in the research setting, we can use it sometimes as an experience, and that will collect the evidence. It is nothing that we should reject or we should accept, but we have to generate our own experience, and SPRM should be considered again an alternative or adjunct to the surgery. These are the few new drugs which are on the research category. I think we don't have because it is not available in the market. So we don't have, but I want to share that these are the drugs which the research world is, pharma people and the RD&D people are doing work on it. So thank you very much for all the active discussion. It was a real wonderful insight. I'm very happy to have this 1 hour full time for the panel discussion. So uterine fibroid, very, very common. And what I'm saying that the minimal invasive method like UAE and the endoscopic are still more beyond the reach for most of the people because of need of highly developed operative skill and advanced technical need. We want to have the good endoscopic OT. We want to have that that expertise available and most of so many group of the patients. So make the right use of medical management, make the right decision for the surgery. GNRH analog has issue of cost and back therapy, BMD, recurrence, and we have to be ready for the future. SPRM is very promising that now we have a good experience for this and a special class of women like young, unmarried, infertile, small size, deep intramural myoma. So there are few situations where the medical management as well as the adjunct or post-operative surgery, it is also important. So again, thank you very much for the wonderful discussion. This is my memory when Udaipur in the rainy season, just in August, I was there for the West Zone Yuva Foxy, a beautiful place. We had a, like, this is a raining and a wonderful memory for us. Hope we will be together physically. And again, I seek your support for my candidature for Foxy president election. The election will be around from December to March this year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sadhana. It was a wonderful discussion and panel. I think I was just wanting to add one thing that I was reading that there was something new coming up, and that is GnRH analog receptors.
I think what I have said, four or five, this allopurinol, this thing, four or five things are in the research category.
Okay.
So I actually put this question if somebody is doing any project work in their institution, because many of you are in the medical college. So this was a question actually sharing of experience, but I don't have even the research data on the use of this drug. So if there is anything, because some drugs are in the pipeline in the research, and let's see that in next 6 to 10 years we have certain.
Ma'am, I want to ask about, you have told about the dose of mifepristone, 50 milligram per week.
Yes, so one paper, it was from Deepti then, and I found it really interesting. Sunday, two tablets, and she has enumerated almost the same effectivity.
Yeah, ma'am, so, because in our government supply, usually the mifepristone is available in 200 milligram dose. So if it is okay, then we can use that drug also in the management of patients.
You can try. I think it is a Sunday
Aditi,
option.
Aditi, but that 200 wala is along with a kit.
Yeah, definitely.
So then you have to waste those 4 mifepristone tablets. Let them buy this single wala thing.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Rajal is with us. Dr. Rajal, your comment anyway, like as a guest of honor, again, thank you very much for staying with us. And your comment also, we will really like to have your expertise.
It was such a wonderful discussion. There is nothing to comment about the panel moderator and the panelists. All were very wonderful. And I had a fond memories of AICOG 2009 at Jaipur. Then, fond memories of Udaipur when I come to Gitanjali for as an examiner. I see very familiar faces of Adumala madam and others. Madam, hello. Coming to Gitanjali. So every time I love to come to Udaipur whenever sir calls for, and because of this COVID time, I couldn't. But then I had some online thing also this year also. And also for the Ajmer, about the Ajmer Sharif. And when I came to Jaipur, it was wonderful city. So all of you, all the best, and madam, all the best for your candidature.
Thank you, Dr. Rajal. It was really good to have you today.
COVID-free days ahead.
Rajasthan must be waiting for its tourists. Now, Rajasthan must be waiting. I'm requesting Khushbu to give a call to Dr. Leela. If she can come for a while, then it will be very happy.
Oh, she was, 1 minute. She rang me up that she was in that wisdom wala thing.
I'll just try, ma'am. Just give me a minute. I'll just try.
Thank you, every panelist, was really. I got so much of point that just I'm going to write few things about this thing, contraceptive action, and what madam has said that in the adolescent we can give at right at any time. So there are many issues which came to our us, and we can optimize the management of fibroid, which is such a common situation. And every panelist gave their beautiful input. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much. It was very good experience sharing.
And we also invite you all for, we are having a midterm ISOPATH conference that will be the hybrid one on prevention of stillbirth. So, 13-14 November. So we will share the flyer to in the group and in your society. And please do join, contribute in paper, very, very nominal fees. And we will cover every aspect of the prevention of stillbirth. So this is, I take this opportunity for inviting everybody for this.
Ma'am, Dr. Sadhana, ma'am, Dr. Leela, ma'am is just joining in 2 minutes. She told, just so give us 2 minutes.
So Dr. Usha, we can wait for 1 or 2 minutes and can, so that she can give her some comment on the program, though she was not there.
Leela ke liye to wait karna padega na.
So it will be nice.
Kyunki nahi to wo friendship wala level hai na, wo mujhe aapne Usha didi wait nahi kiya mere liye.
उन्होंने कहा था कि वो ना एक्चुअली देन एट 4 PM, लेकिन उन्होंने कहा कि वो आपने कहा और जयपुर का मतलब लाइक राजस्थान सोसाइटी, तो हम कभी भी आ जाएंगे. उन्होंने कहा तो हमने
कहा शी रैंग मी अप इन द आफ्टरनून, शी सेड कि आर यू कन्वे माय
And I think we will say na, such an esteemed teacher from Rajasthan. Actually, one thing which is really troubles me a lot, that is the Naita, such a wonderful clinician, and you know what we have, the experienced clinician. This tricky situation, and we really need your like as a teacher, as a academician, as a clinician, we really need your suggestion that how we can make Usha ji, all the leaders, that we can make Indian presence feel in the scientific world. So like on 26, we are having a Yuva Speaks webinar on this, crossing barriers to publication. And we really like to have your inputs that how this scenario can be changed, that we have a quality publication and not necessarily in Western world, because you know, there are a lot of concern from the developing world, from the even Latin American countries, that like 5 million delivery in Western world, and we are having a like 60 million delivery, 27 million only in India. So we should have our own experience. We should have our own issues to be discussed friendly and not to be overburdened. Or hamesha hum log ek low complex se rahe ki like we are not giving and they are giving and we are like cramming up ACOG and RCOG. So I really want to bring all academicians on the this line, that we have to make our country scientifically sound, and like we say, China presence, Taiwan presence, even Iran's presence in scientific world. And it really pricks me a lot. This is something which really hurts me.
Yeah, before last, we were having those POGs, you know, where the Indian guidelines were being prepared. As per
for few things, Indian guidelines, but actually, what you say, the likeness, scientific presence in the world. If yeah. you say that we say the good quality experience, debates, and something for the that what happens. So, we have like we are having POCSI guidelines for many issues, and we have to improvise that to make it like a solid base. And a good presence in the scientific world. So I really invite every academician to give a thought and always, like give suggestion that how can we make this presence left? Because and you know, it was a wonderful discussion in that side today. And that is to be like converted into India's presence. Dr. Rajan, your opinion about it. We have just 5, yes. Leela ji aa gaye, Dr. Leela.
Yes ma'am, we have Dr. Leela. Hello ma'am. Ma'am please un.
Sorry madam, sorry.
Are aapke liye sab. So we welcome Leela. Dr. Leela and yes
Dr. Leela jo intezar karaya hai uske liye coffee pilani padegi.
Are yaar dal do le coffee wo kettle la ke dalu, abhi to online
hai. Ye aise wali virtual coffee nahi peene wali hu main. वर्चुअल कॉफी नहीं पीने वाली हूँ मैं, आके पीने वाली हूँ.
ठीक है ठीक है, ओके.
डॉक्टर साधना, यू आल्सो इनवाइटेड.
हाँ जी
डॉक्टर साधना मैम हेलो
We had a wonderful panel on conservative management of fibroids. And there were multiple clinical questions also, Leela.
Yes.
So we missed you on the, your inputs. That. Dr. Sadha yes. had prepared the panel as a moderator.
So,
and we
had I think the panel has finished.
I think the time is over. That's why they locked off.
No, ma'am, you can just, Dr. Leela, we request you to say a few words for that sort of
So, yes, ma'am, actually, I've seen your questions that for fibroid, which is a big problem, the age related and all, we are getting fibroids in very early ages also. So, all the learned panelists must have answered very nicely. But one thing from my side that we have to do more research whether the which medical treatment will be effective, especially the unmarried girls, which is I think it becomes as endometrioma, fibroid, these have become a social stigma because all the parents, if you ask them, we have to remove it always. All parents are concerned about kya hoga, shadi karni hai, abhi to ladki ki shadi nahi hui hai. So more and more research are required for the medical management. Because this uliprostol, as it came and it has gone back, the mifepristone, we are doing all studies on that, and we'll see what is what we will get. And really, I'm very sorry, I was not able to join this panel, but I know Sadhana ma'am as one of the expert person. You ask her to speak on any topic. So she can speak, and she is very hardworking. And madam, I always admire you. Madam, ka aapko pata hoga, she is from Gorakhpur. I think a small city, but madam is doing everything over there. That even the infertility center, I think the first of the infertility center is there. And one thing, madam, that in COVID time, she mentioned that one patient of placenta percreta, she opened, and how she shifted that patient in that COVID time to a higher center and saved that patient. That is that I know. So ma'am, all the best for your future endeavors. And really, I'm sorry to join late, but thank you. Thank you for calling. Yes.
Thank you, Dr.
Leela.
Mushadi,
thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Leela. You could make it. We are really very happy to have you at least in
ma'am.
The last, because
really, I'm very sorry. मैं कुछ दिमाग से निकल गया पता नहीं क्या हुआ.
Thank you very much for.
अभी तो मैम जॉग्स मारेगा मुझे. डॉक्टर उषा मेरी जरा लगाएंगी. जी.
Thank you once again for everything and over to Dr. Kushbo for your vote of thanks by the office bearers.
It was a wonderful insight for all of us, and we'll definitely work on uplifting this medical management of fibroids as a therapy with fibroids as a brand, definitely. Thank you so much, doctors, for your participation and your time. Thanks a lot. And thank you, Dr. Leela and Dr. Rajal for joining as a chief guest and guest of honor. Thank you, Dr. Sadhana, for coordinating with me for this wonderful session and insights, and all the panelists and Jaipur Obs Gyne, Udaipur Obs Gyne and Ajmer Obs Gyne Societies. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Okay, bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kushbu, for all this opportunity. Thank you to bringing us all together. Thank you. So we can leave.
Thank you, doctors. Yeah, ma'am. We can just log on.